Recall that chronic myeloid leukemia has three phases. First mutation that causes reciprocal translocation between chromosome 9 and 22 results in significant increase in proliferation of granulocytes. As a result, the amount of mature granulocytes in the blood markedly increase. This causes increase in total white blood cell count, but such overproduction of mature granulocytes do not cause any significant symptoms. And this stage called chronic stage of chronic myeloid leukemia. Then the second mutation occurs, and this mutation disrupts cellular maturation. And because maturation becomes disrupted, this results in production of less mature granulocytes. Because of first mutation, the proliferation rate remains very high, so the total amount of granulocytes and thereby white blood cells with time continue to increase. But because the second mutation caused decrease in cellular maturation, the percentage of less mature cells increase, and what is really important, even blood cells begin to accumulate. And the state when overproduction with progressive accumulation of granulocytes occurs simultaneously with partially disrupted maturation, and this causes accumulation of blood cells in the bone marrow from 10 to 19%, called accelerated phase of chronic myeloid leukemia. Accumulation of blood cells lead to dramatic consequences. The reason is that bone marrow is 100% packed with cells, and in normal state, myeloblasts take up 2% from all space of the bone marrow. And when mutation causes progressive accumulation of blood cells basically crowd out normal cells from the bone marrow. So with increasing amount of blood cells, the amount of erythroblasts decrease and thereby the production of red blood cells will decrease. Decreasing amount of red blood cells will cause decrease in hemoglobin concentration, so anemia develops. Also increase in blood cells will cause decrease in production of platelets, so thrombocytopenia develops. And also blood cells crowd out lymphatic cells from the bone marrow, thereby the production of lymphocytes decrease, so lymphopenia develops. And also increase in blood cells force lymphoid cells to leave the bone marrow and migrate to the spleen. Increase in amount of cells in the splenic tissue cause splenomegaly, and after cells migrate to the liver, and increase in amount of cells in the liver will cause hepatomegaly. And with time, additional mutations that disrupt maturation can occur. So now maturation process will be going even slower. As a result, a lot of immature granulocytes are produced, and the amount of blood cells progressively increase and becomes greater than 20%. And because of this, this stage called blast crisis. The higher becomes the number of blood cells, the lesser space is left for normal cells, so the higher will be the amount of normal cells that are forced to leave. So every pathological alteration that occurs during accelerated phase now becomes more severe. So anemia becomes more severe, thrombocytopenia, lymphopenia, also the size of the spleen and the size of the liver increase. Now, which clinical symptoms are characteristic for chronic myeloid leukemia? In accelerated phase of chronic myeloid leukemia, blood cells begin to accumulate and force all other cells to leave the bone marrow. First of all, it causes decrease in red blood cells and hemoglobin, thereby anemia develops. Anemia will manifest with typical anemic symptoms. Initially, in accelerated phase, it's weakness, fatigue, pale skin, shortness of breath during physical exercises. But with increasing amount of blood, matters get worse. And in blood crisis, the amount of red blood cells and the concentration of hemoglobin decrease even further. And now patients will have severe fatigue, shortness of breath even at rest, irregular heartbeats, and lightheadedness. Also with increase in blood cells, the amount of platelets decrease. Thrombocytopenia disrupts primary hemostasis, and disruption of primary hemostasis manifests with increase in bleeding time. Also it causes bleeding from mucous membranes, primarily from GI tract, but also frequently they have nose bleeding, so-called epistaxis, and microhemorrhages develops that on skin manifest with petechia purpura ecchymosis. Obviously, in blood crisis, because the amount of platelets decrease even further, all clinical manifestations will be more severe. Most frequently, it can be complicated by severe bleeding from upper GI tract regions that will manifest with black stool, so-called melena, or by severe bleeding from lower GI tract regions, and this will manifest with bright red blood in a stool, so-called hematoschisia. In addition to this, microhemorrhages become more severe, so a lot of purpura and ecchymosis develops. Also, increase in blood cells force lymphoid cells to migrate from the bone marrow, so the production of lymphocytes decrease, thereby lymphopenia develops. And lymphopenia markedly increases the risk of viral infections. Increase in blasts force lymphocytes to migrate from the bone marrow initially to the spleen. As a result, the size of the spleen increases, so splenomegaly develops. Splenomegaly manifests with abdominal discomfort and early satiety that cause loss of appetite. With abdominal discomfort, everything is clear. Obviously, if patient has enlarged spleen, it will compress anatomical structure nearby and it will cause discomfort. But how to explain loss of appetite? Usually, when we consume food, this food incomes into the stomach, where it causes pressure on gastric walls, and exactly this pressure of food that causes distension of the gastric walls gives us a sense of satiety. But in case of splenomegaly, the larger becomes the spleen, the more it compresses the stomach. And the more compressed is the stomach, the smaller becomes the stomach volume. So the less amount of food is needed to increase intragastric pressure and thereby to cause distension of the gastric walls. So the lesser food is needed to provoke a sense of satiety. And because of that, patients with splenomegaly have loss of appetite. And obviously, decrease in food consumption potentially can cause decrease in body weight. And if spleen is fully filled with cells, then lymphoid cells are going into another previous place of hematopoiesis, which is liver. And now they will progressively accumulate also in the liver tissue, so the size of the liver will increase, and this will cause hepatomegaly. Hepatomegaly usually manifests with right upper quadrant abdominal discomfort. With time, the amount of blasts increase, and the higher the amount of malignant blast cells in the bone marrow, the higher will be the amount of lymphoid cells that are forced to leave the bone marrow. So the higher will be the risk of viral infection, and also the larger will become the spleen, and the larger will become the liver. So in blast crisis, splenomegaly and hepatomegaly will be even more severe. And logically, the more severe will become the clinical manifestations that are provoked by them. The problem is that at some point, spleen becomes so large that a condition called hypersplenism develops. The concept is that the larger becomes the spleen, the more reactive become splenic macrophages. And at some point, enlargement of the spleen overstimulates macrophages, and now they will begin to consume by phagocytosis normal red blood cells and platelets. And this results in their destruction. So the more severe becomes chronic myeloid leukemia, the larger becomes the spleen, the higher is the chance that splenic macrophages will cause rapid premature destruction of red blood cells and platelets. So hypersplenism causes destruction of red blood cells and platelets, that aggravates anemia and thrombocytopenia that are already present. We see that actually there are a lot of problems, but we can say, okay, but we have a lot of white blood cells, especially neutrophils, so against bacteria we are protected. And the fact is, absolutely not. The problem here is that malignant neutrophils do not know how to produce alkaline phosphatase. Recall that the function of neutrophils is to provide defense against the bacteria. And because of this, inside them, they have a lot of bacteria-killing enzymes. And one of these enzymes is alkaline phosphatase. And because the function of neutrophils is to provide defense against the bacteria, the expression of this enzyme in DNA and thereby the production of this enzyme in neutrophils is extremely high. The problem is that mutations that occur in malignant cell disrupt the genetic expression of this enzyme. Simply speaking, with mutation, neutrophils forget how to produce alkaline phosphatase. Thereby, the amount of alkaline phosphatase becomes very low, and without this enzyme, neutrophils cannot kill the bacteria, and this greatly increases the risk of bacterial infection. So, in chronic myeloid leukemia, despite the presence of great amount of neutrophils, neutrophils do not have alkaline phosphatase, and thereby they cannot provide immune defense against the bacteria, and this markedly increases the risk of bacterial infections. In addition to this, neutrophils secrete a lot of cytokines, and as we know, at night the secretion of pro-inflammatory cytokines increase. As a result, increase in cytokine secretion causes symptoms as fever and night sweats. Additional problem is that the higher the amount of cells, the higher is the rate of cell turnover. In chronic myeloid leukemia, we have a lot of white blood cells. Basically, we have huge amount of neutrophils, and in addition to this, we have huge amount of blasts. And all these cells have nucleus that contains DNA. Recall that even in normal condition, when cell dies, it releases the inner content into the blood. And when nucleus released, from nucleus into the blood also enters DNA molecule. And the end products of DNA degradation are nucleic acids. Nucleic acids are initially converted into hypoxanthine and then by xanthine oxidase into xanthine and after into the uric acid. The problem in chronic myeloid leukemia is that there are a lot of cells, and their turnover results in constant income of nucleic acids into the blood, and thereby in production of huge amount of uric acid. And accumulation of uric acid markedly increases the risk of gout and also increases the risk of kidney stones. So the turnover of huge amount of white blood cells results in constant production of huge amount of uric acid that increases the risk of gout and kidney stones.
If you like content, please press like and subscribe button. All the best!